As we begin, the church politely requests no video or photography during the service. I also want you to know that many of you have asked, how can we help? And there's a simple way that the Scruggs family has made a request to everyone here, inside and outside, that you can help immediately. Today, all throughout the service, they want to hear every one of your voices singing loudly. You can help the Scruggs family by joining the chorus as we remember the life of Hallie Scruggs. While still in our grief, we rejoice because our Redeemer lives, and Hallie does too. So let's sing. Join me in the call to worship. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongue with shouts of joys. Then they said among the nations, "The Lord has done great things for them." The Lord has done great things for us. We're God. Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like the streams in the Negev. Those who sow in tears shall reap with shouts of joy. He who goes out weeping, bearing the seed for sowing, shall come home with shouts of joy, bringing his sheaves with him. Please be seated. We're gathered here today to give thanks to the Lord who lives and reigns, to grieve with the Scruggs family over the loss of Hallie Liddell Scruggs, to express gratitude for her life and the light that she was and is, and to sing to one another the promises of God that surround and cover her and all of his people. Let's pray. Father, you are the one who has promised us that you'll satisfy the weary soul, and every languishing soul you will replenish. You keep a record of our sorrows. You keep our tears in your bottle. And in the day that we call, we know, God, you are for us. And in you we trust, and we will not be afraid. You are the King. You are the King who came down into our suffering and into our grief, the King who is also the man of sorrows, the King who acquainted himself with our grief, who has borne our grief and carried away our sorrows, and by your wounds and by your sorrows, you bring healing, because you are the King who is also the great healer. Heal us now, we pray. In the name of Jesus, the risen King, we pray. Amen. Paul in Romans 6 reminds us, "Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing, so that we would no longer be enslaved to sin. For one who has died has been set free from sin. Now if we have died with Christ, we believe we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him." At this moment, as the spring brings back our flowers, that's a small reminder of new life after the death of winter. And so at this moment, we'd like to invite the children of the Covenant School to come forward and place their flowers in this basket in celebration and in honor of the life of Hallie Liddell Scruggs.
Thank you.
Down through the ages, God's people have gathered together and said together, stated out loud, what it is we believe. This exercise is not rote. It's to remember that we share in a historic faith. We share with those who have gone before us. A historic faith that we share with those who will come after us from faith, from age to age. And we say it loudly because everyone's faith falters at times, and we minister to one another here today when we hear one another profess. So brothers and sisters, stand and share with one another, Christian, what is our only comfort in life and death? What is it that you believe?
Yeah. Don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come back to take you to be with me, so that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to the place that I'm going. And Thomas said, Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? And Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And please be seated. We've been studying through John in our church, and we have gotten to the place where Jesus is with his disciples by themselves in the upper room, and this is part of that, what's called the upper room discourse. And he is on the verge, on the night before, the most painful, traumatic night that any person could ever go through. And twice, once in John 12 and once in John 13, he has talked about how his soul was troubled. And then he's washing his disciples' feet, and he says, what I'm doing you don't understand now, but afterwards you will understand. And that was about why he was washing their feet, but that's a general principle. Jesus does things that we don't understand. And he says, you just got to trust me. And that's what he's saying to us right now. What I'm doing right now, you don't understand, but you will. He is telling us that things will happen that we'll never understand this side of heaven, and that peace in those times only come through knowing him. And he is also, on the night before his greatest night, greatest day of agony, he is more concerned about his disciples than he is for himself. And he tells them, I don't want you to be troubled. I want to say this right now. When Chad preaches and Ryan preaches, they always are really good about saying, okay, young disciples, I want you to listen to what I have to say and listen for this. I think that's really great. And as I was thinking about these flowers, and so what our school children have been through this week, this is all for you. Adults, you can listen if you want. Jesus said his soul is troubled, and yet he tells us not to be troubled. Don't let our hearts be troubled. Why? Why would he do that? Is it okay for me and not for you? No, it's because the trouble that Jesus was going to endure is a tsunami compared to a ripple with the trouble that we go through. Jesus was about to go to the cross and endure the wrath of his Father so that we wouldn't have to. He was going through overwhelming trouble that caused him to sweat drops of blood so that he can tell us, don't let your hearts be troubled. It's a difference. It's the same word, but it's a different from degree. And what he's saying is death cannot hurt you because it hurt me. One of my favorite stories that is so appropriate at a time like this is about a minister in Philadelphia, Donald Gray Barnhouse, and his wife died when his children were young. And they went to the memorial service, and they were leaving the memorial service, and his young daughter said, Daddy, if Jesus died for us, why did Mama have to die? It's a pretty good question, isn't it? And at that time, a big tractor trailer drove by, and in between, and it cast a shadow on them as it drove by, and he looked at his daughter, and he said, if you were going to get hit by one of those, would you rather be hit by the truck or by the shadow? He said, well, of course, by the shadow. He said, Jesus was hit by the truck of death so that all we would have to endure was a shadow. And we walked through the valley of the shadow of death. In this passage, I want to use it to acknowledge the fact that Everybody has been through trauma, and nobody knows the answers. Nobody knows why. And I want to say that on the front end. But what Jesus said is, you will have trouble. And here is how I want you to endure it. And he gives us three things, three words, a word of encouragement, a word of comfort, and a word of invitation. The first thing he gives us is a word of encouragement. Trust him. Believe in him. Don't let your hearts be troubled. Believe in me. Believe is an active word. It's a verb. Y'all have had English teachers that have taught you this. It tells us to do something. And what it tells us to do is to apply what you know to be true about Jesus to this situation in your lives. Now, what do we know to be true? We know that he loves us. And we know that he'll hold us fast. The Apostle Paul said, who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it's written, for your sake we're being killed all day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure, same word, that neither death nor life nor angels or rulers or things present or things to come or powers or height or depth or anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that's in Christ. We know that he loves us. Whatever we're going through right now is not because he does not love us. We are precious in his sight. And we know he's faithful to all of his promises. All the paths of the Lord are steadfast love and faithfulness for those who keep his covenant. And we know that Hallie belonged to Jesus. We just read the height of our catechism. And I want to tell you what we just read. We read that Hallie was not her own, that she belonged body and soul in life and in death to her faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. He had fully paid for all of her sins with his precious blood, and he had set her free from the tyranny of the devil. He was also watching over her in such a way that not a hair could have fallen from her head without the will of her good, good Father in heaven. And that all of the things that have happened in her life have worked together for her salvation. Because she belonged to him. Christ, by his Holy Spirit, has assured her of eternal life, which she is now experiencing with him in heaven. That's the truth. It doesn't make it hurt less, but it gives us hope. When Chad and Jada had her baptized 9 years ago at Park City's Prez, and somebody stood up and asked them these questions, and you've heard them all right here if you come to this church. As you do the baptismal vows, and one of the things they ask is, do you unreservedly dedicate your child to God? And they asked him that. And if Jesus would have walked up to Chad and Jada and said, okay, sit down, I want to explain to you what that means, that you're giving her to me. When she's 9 years old, I'm going to take her home to be with me. And it's going to be really painful. But I'm going to use that to bring glory to my name in a way that you could not even imagine. I don't know that I would have said yes to that. So Jesus doesn't ask us. But that's what he did. Now, as always, Christ is honored in her body, whether by life or by death. For her to live was Christ, and to die was gain. If you know the who of this life, it makes the why and the what less overwhelming. And now there's a word of comfort. She's home. Jesus goes right into talking about heaven. Don't let your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. He's talking about heaven. He's saying this isn't your home. This is home. And that's where she is. We're convinced that she's with the Lord right now. We grieve, but not like those who have no hope. This is painful, but it will be temporary. She's been in heaven for 5 days. If she could come down right now and stand here, what do you think she'd tell us? I've been told that she and my wife, who had a special relationship, have already formed a greeting committee in heaven, and so everybody's getting welcome there, giving everybody a loaf of bread when they get there. I don't doubt that. I don't know what she'd say, but I want to tell you what I'm pretty sure she'd say. The first thing I'm pretty sure she would say, she's a country music fan, and her favorite song says, "I've gotten where I'm going, and I see Jesus' face, and I'm going to stand forever in the light of his amazing grace. I've gotten where I'm going, so don't cry for me down here." She would say, "Don't cry for me." Jonathan Edwards, who was a pastor that lived in the 1700s, wrote this long, I guess it was a sermon, it's like a book, but it's called Heaven is a World of Love. And in that, this is what he says, and this is her experience right now. Hallie knows that God loves her and that she will never doubt the greatness of his love, and she will have no doubt of the love of all her fellow citizens in heaven. She will never have any fear that the love of God will ever diminish towards her, or that Christ will not continue always to love her with an undying tenderness and affection. In heaven, the love of God will become a stream, a river, an ocean. All will stand around. The glory of God, who is a great fountain of love in their souls, will be filled with the waves of his love and will flourish in beauty and fragrance of his cheering rays. Don't cry for me down here. But I know one thing she would say for sure. I see Jesus. And he's high and exalted, and he's sitting on a throne, and the train of his robe fills the temple, and the whole world is full of his glory. He's on a throne. He is ruling. She would say, I know all this that has happened seems really big, but Jesus is so much bigger. He is bigger. This seems like it's out of control, but it's not. Apply what you know to be true and take comfort on the fact that she's with him. Remember that this is not our home. And our God is in heaven, and he does whatever he pleases. But it's also a word of invitation. At the very end, he says, I'm going to go and prepare a place for you, and when I finish, I'll come back and take you to be with me. If you were listening to that in that day and time, that would be a proposal for marriage. The man would come, and remember, you only propose marriage to somebody that you really love and want to spend the rest of your life with. Which says something about the way Jesus relates to us. So you would come and you'd pay the bride price, you would offer marriage, and then you would go back and get a house ready. And then you'd come back and get your bride. So what Jesus is saying right now, and I can say this to each of you right now, that he loves you. And he offers you to become part of his bride. He paid the price for your sins. And he said, will you marry me? Will you trust me to forgive you of your sins? Would you commit your life to me? Much like you do when you get married. And he said, the only ones that are going to be with me in eternity in heaven are part of my family, my bride. And that offer is for all of us right here. When my wife was 16, her best friend was her cousin, Love, and when she was, she was godly, they both were. And, but Love had a date one night and she went out and she always wore blue jeans and always, you know, they lived on a horse farm. And so she went out on this date one night and she came down and she had on a dress. And her mother said, Love, what are you doing there? She said, just a special night. Well, she goes out and hadn't gotten out of the driveway too far, and they have a wreck. And it's really serious, and they have to take Love to the hospital, and she's in the emergency room, and John, her father, goes down, and my father-in-law, who's a pastor, sits next to him, and they're sitting, all the families in the waiting room, and Frank said, John looked at him, and he said, you know, at a time like this, there's only one thing that matters. Do they know Jesus? At a time like this, there's only one thing that matters for any of you out there. Do you know Jesus? Well, Love, she died, and the doctor came out and said, I hate to tell you, but we couldn't save her. And John Cowart looked at my father-in-law with tears and a broken heart. And he said, that's one home safe. That's one home safe. I'm so sorry. our hearts are broken for y'all. We love you. And we will do whatever we can to love you the way that you have loved us. Would you stand and sing with me, Be Thou My Vision?
You may be seated. I got to tell you, on Monday, this seemed like a really good idea. Now it doesn't seem like a good idea. I need to get a couple things out of the way. The first is I just assume I'm going to be a mess up here. It would also help me if y'all were a mess too. We can all just be a mess together, and it'll help me get through this. I can't also help but think of the day that God gave us to celebrate the life of my daughter. If you knew Hallie, then you knew that a sunny day with wind at about 45 miles an hour really kind of perfectly describes her. The first thing I want to do is I want to thank y'all on behalf of my family. I just thank you. I see you out in the halls and the foyer, and thank y'all so much. You've been incredible to us, really no words. We have felt so incredibly loved by your presence, almost embarrassingly so, by that outpouring of support that we've received. You never really know how you're going to feel or what you're going to want until you're in the middle of something like this, totally against your will. But we can say together that we have wanted you. And one of the things that has helped us thus far, it sounds simple, I know, but it has helped us so much just to know that my little girl was seen. That you saw her, that her presence was felt. And as the youngest and only sister of three brothers, that may seem like a tough challenge, but if you knew Hallie at all, you know that she had no problem making her presence known. Often sweaty, often barefoot, looking back through pictures, often with food on her face, she was a force. And not only did you see her with us, but you loved her with us, and it has helped us not to feel alone in our heartbreak. The Bible tells us that we are supposed to celebrate and remember the works of God, and since Hallie Liddell Scruggs is among his works, I want to take a few minutes to remember her and to celebrate her with you. Hallie was awesome. She was awesome. She is awesome. And what I felt most over the last week is just incredibly proud to be her dad. In fact, while the last few days have been overwhelmingly sad, one of the things we have felt most over the course of the last 6 days has been gratitude. I am so grateful that I got to be Hallie's dad for almost 10 years. Whenever I even say that, my heart swells with pride. She made our lives so rich, so fun, so much more at work, but absolutely memorable. The phrase, never a dull moment, could have been trademarked for Hallie. Those of you who knew her will know that Hallie was not a prim and proper, cautious, Hallmark little girl. There's nothing wrong with that, by the way, if you're one of those, but that's just not the little girl that God gave us. Maybe it was because she was raised by three brothers, but Hallie always, always, always preferred balls to dolls. She preferred chest bumps and fist bumps and elaborate handshake routines and dabbing people up. I will always be daddy to her. That was her first name for me. That turned into dad a little bit later. More recently, I was dude and even bruh at times. She was my baby girl. That was the first name I called her by. My baby girl. That changed to Bobby girl, Hallie bug. Depending on her mood, it was stink bug or ladybug. Our Dallas friends called her Cheeto. Our neighborhood favorite was Hallie Badger, which is a perfect fit. My wife and I, my wife and Hallie had such an incredibly special bond. There was no one in this world that Hallie loved more than her mama. And she always had to know exactly where you were. Where's mom? That is a question that I will never hear in anyone's voice but hers. She was Jada's sidekick, her shadow, Aunt Beck. Jada's sister used to impersonate Hallie and say, "Where's my best friend Jada? Where's my best friend Jada?" And all of this is funny and beautiful because Jada and Hallie could not be more different. On Jade and I's first date, I came to visit her at her house in Jackson, and at some point during that date, I asked if she wanted to go outside and throw a ball of frisbee, whatever she had, and I kid you not, there was none in the entire house. I didn't even believe that you could have a house and that be possible, not even a tennis ball. And I feel justified because Hallie would have been just as shocked and disappointed as I was. Jada was a cheerleader. I threatened Hallie with being a cheerleader if she acted up. Jada hated getting dirty growing up. Hallie lived with dirt under her fingernails. Jada wore dresses. Hallie was camo sweatpants, Umbro shorts, or that hideous kitten hoodie that she wanted so badly for Christmas that year. Two of Jada's favorite stories to tell is that one day leaving the WNSL field, some of you will know that is if you're local, we spent a lot of hours there with flag football, and Hallie spent a lot of hours watching her brothers play flag football and playing beside them, playing on the sidelines. And one of the days we were leaving, she saw a Harpeth Hall girls team, quarterbacked by none other than Louisa Brown over there. And Hallie turned to Jada and said, "Mama, I did not know we could do that." The other is the time that Jada decided, against my wishes, to put Hallie in ballet. Again, if you know Hallie, I want to let that sink in for a moment. Hallie in ballet. There's just no better contrast. But she did it, not her favorite thing in the world. One day, Jada went to pick her up from practice, and she watched her little girl that she had dreamed about having for so long doing her ballet routine. And all the other little girls were twirling in their little ballet leotards, and Hallie was twirling too, and she had just finished her twirl. She turned, and she chest-bumped the girl next to her, which is not a ballet move, just to clarify that. And we thought that was a fitting conclusion to her ballet career. And also, I would say, the end of trying to make Hallie into someone that she clearly wasn't. And yet, for all their differences, boy, did that little girl love her mama. For years, Jada lay down with her at night. I mean, years. Or sat right outside her room so that she would fall asleep. Jada would always say to her at night, "You know you're my favorite daughter, right?" And Hallie would respond, "You know you're my favorite mama, right?" And then Hallie would say a word that will make no sense to anybody because it's not actually a word. She made it up. She would say, "Dooey dooey gaga," which meant, "Put your arm under my head." And Hallie would fall asleep right there on Jada's shoulder because you made her soul rest. And you warded off her anxiety. And you calmed her heart. And one of your arms will always be stronger than the other because you carried her on your hip for the first 2 years of her life. You baked together. You took walks together. You ran errands together. You would often come home and say, "She is driving me crazy." The questions, the need to be around you all the time. And I would just laugh and say, "Well, you got your girl, didn't you?" And you did, because Hallie was always your girl, and she will always be your girl. Hallie loved her brothers as well. There is no doubt that Hallie was Hallie because of y'all, because she had three older brothers. And so her friends, some she got to pick, most she didn't, were your friends. She wanted more than anything else to be like you guys. Whatever you were doing, that was what she wanted to grow up and be, to play basketball and football and to play golf and to fish and to play in the creek and to stay up late with you as late as she could and say the things you said. And look at me, I know that drove you crazy, trying to figure out ways to include your little sister in everything that you were doing. But she loved y'all so much. And I know how much you loved her, because at night when she was scared, you would make room to let her sleep with you. And I know at the time that you hated being the one that she chose to get in bed with, because Hallie slept like she lived, wild and free and really sweaty. But you were her comfort. You were the one she ran to. One of the common experiences in our house that happened over and over again was that one of the brothers, I won't name names here, would do something that hurt Hallie's feeling or literally hurt her physically. Mostly her fault. She would throw herself into whatever y'all were doing. And I was always her protector and her advocate against the boys. I was the one who could bully them in return. So she would come to me and tell on them. And I would say, what do you want me to do to them? Anything. You name the torture. And she would make a list of the way to torture them and her exact vengeance that would always go something like this. I want you to tickle them, spank them, limpy them, which means flick them really hard. And it would always end with throw them on the ground. And I would go and play and do all those things, and they would act like it was just torture to y'all, and it would totally turn her tears into giggling. And that is what y'all did so well. You brought out the best in her, you brought out the worst in her, and you brought out the best in her again. She loved y'all so much for it. You may have heard me say this, but I, as a dad, I wanted a little girl at every ultrasound. Sorry, guys. And of course, Hallie was a surprise. We thought we were done with three kids, but finally, the little girl came, and I am so glad that she came last because she had you boys to look up to. And I am so proud of y'all. I am so proud of y'all. And so was she. She was proud to be John Randall's and Charlie's and Carter's little sister. I could go on and on about who and how much Hallie loved. She really didn't have enemies. I don't say that tritely. I mean, I would tell you. I could name grandparents and cousins, her neighborhood friends, Olivia, her school friends, her Dallas friends, her soccer and basketball friends, many of you we've seen come down, her vacation friends, definitely her church friends. Hallie loved so many, and I would no doubt leave someone out. And I can't tell you how much joy it brings us and has brought us over the past week to hear all of you tell stories that we don't even know about how you remember her and what she has meant to you and how her light has transcended that which she brought to our household. I do want to say that we are incredibly grateful to God for the last couple weeks that we got to spend with Hallie. 2 weeks ago on spring break, we got to take a family mission trip with some of our favorite people from our church to Belize, and she was so in her element. The adventure, the energy, the hair braids, the Belizean kids she loved, the games of jackpot in the morning with the boys while all the girls were off doing other things. As soon as we got home, she asked, can we go back next year? Then our final weekend together is one we'll never forget. By God's grace, the last weekend we spent with her, which was last weekend, she got to do all of her favorite things. On Friday night, Jada and I went to our precious dinner group, and Hallie got to stay home with her brothers, which was always a little bit of a vacation for her. On Saturday, it was 4 hours with the Kandros family, one of her second families. She got to play soccer and football with Rivers and Mo and Augie. When she came home on Saturday afternoon, she played with Olivia all afternoon, her neighborhood soulmate. And on Sunday, I had my final one-on-one time with my sweet girl. After church, I was tired, as often happens, and was looking forward to just crashing on the couch and watching golf. And just as I'd gotten comfortable, of course, Hallie jumped on me. I always had great timing. She had a football in her hand and said, Dad, will you throw with me? I was so tired, I tried to put her off. I said no, but you can only say no so many times. She was so persistent. So finally I said, okay. But Hallie, don't you want to play basketball or soccer or something that you're involved in, something other than football? To which she replied, Dad, it's the off season. This is the time you get better. And so on a bright, sunny Sunday afternoon, we went outside, and she took off her shoes, and she made me teach her routes, an out route, a post, an in route, and we threw football for almost an hour, just me and her, me and my baby girl, and we laughed, and we teased each other, and she was so happy, and I was so happy. She was not the girl I'd always wanted, but she was so much more. So much more than I ever deserved. She was such a gift. Billy mentioned it, but one of the baptismal vows that we take in our church is the third one that he mentioned, this line. It's, do you unreservedly dedicate your child to God? And I have thought about that vow so much this week because to me, it's always been the scariest one. Do you unreservedly dedicate your child to God? That is, can you right now say, Lord, she belongs to you, she is yours. And in one sense, you are only saying what is already true. Lord, this is the child you've made, that you love more than me, that you have gifted to me for only a season to be her earthly father. But in another sense, at that moment you were saying, Jesus, have your way with her, even if that comes at the cost of my own heartbreak and suffering. She is unreservedly yours. And never, ever have I felt that vow more than this week. And never have I been more convinced that she was his gift to us for any amount of time this side of heaven that we would have the joy of savoring that gift. After we received the news that Jesus had taken his little girl home, it was a grace. No one else knew. And so we got home before anyone else could find out, and we told the boys, and we wept and we wailed in our front yard, prostrate for a long time. And that night, things began to sink in, and one of the first thoughts I had was, I don't know how I can ever drive up this hill again. I don't know how I can go to this building and walk through these halls and be in this sanctuary. But then God impressed upon my heart, you absolutely have to go back. And you will go back, because evil cannot win. And though Hallie was killed in this building, just a few hundred yards from here, more importantly, she was formed to love Jesus in this building. And she loved this church, and she worshiped in this church because this was her church. And we do not believe that the devil gets to claim this place as his own. And so to do her funeral here was not only to remember her and to remember the place she loved. This is our protest against the powers of darkness. Worshiping the resurrected Jesus, who is our only hope in life and in death, the one to whom Hallie prayed, whom she loved, and to whom she was always consecrated. The last memory I have in Hallie in the sanctuary, it was last Sunday, I was right behind that table. I was overseeing communion, which is the Lord's Supper, or however you want to call it, your tradition, the Eucharist, and Hallie came up in hand with Jada, as she always did. And Jada ate and drank the bread and wine, the sign of Jesus' body and his blood given for us, the sign of his presence with us, the sign of him being our host and our nourishment. And like she always was, Hallie came up smiling. But she couldn't eat and drink just yet. She had been asking to make a profession of faith and come to the table and eat and drink as a communing member for over a year, and she was so ready, but I had just not gotten to it. And she was finally scheduled to come to the table to make her first communion this year on Mother's Day. And I will never forget the image of her coming up last Sunday with joy, with anticipation that this sign would finally be hers. And she never got to that table. But instead, she now has in fullness all that that table ever represented. The things we only get to taste in promise. And on March 27th, 2023, Hallie Liddell Scruggs became a communing member in the House of Zion. And the Jesus that she loved by faith became hers by sight. And she was welcomed to a banqueting table and to a party that Jesus had always been fitting her for. I will never, ever get to walk her down the aisle. But she is forever with the groom to whom we unreservedly dedicate her. And so in some ways, her baptism was the day that this daddy gave his daughter away. And we are convinced that there is no husband more perfect than him. On Monday night, through tears, one of my elders said to me, it's the first night, he pulled me aside and he grabbed my arm and he said, I hope you believe all the things you've been telling us all these years. And I can only say publicly this afternoon, more than ever, yes, and more than ever, we believe in the resurrection of the body, and we believe in the life of the world to come. And by God's grace, we will walk with a limp toward that world from here on out. I am so proud to be her daddy. So proud to be her bra. I am so grateful for the gift of my little girl. We're going to close this afternoon with two songs. The first was Hallie's favorite. She probably could have written this liturgy. All these were really Hallie's favorites. The second, among her favorites for sure, and Britton already said it, even if you don't know the words, even if you struggle to believe the words, would you sing them with us? They are songs of our confidence. They are our songs of protest. They are our songs of hope. Let's stand now and sing.
I
So the family is going to go back here for a minute, but would love to greet you all out in the front. We had great plans with the tent, and the wind kind of started blowing everything down, but I don't know how we're going to do it, but they would love for you all to come and say hello and greet them. On the back of your bulletin, you see this picture. For Christmas last year, Hallie made all of her family a Christmas card, and this is what she drew. So this is her gift and blessing to you, which we will repeat right now. Raise your hearts to the Lord. May the Lord bless you and keep you. And may the Lord cause his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, both now and forever. Amen.